Hello viewers, welcome to another session on cosmetics. As you remember, in our last session we discussed about various types of powders including face powder and talcum powder and antiperspirants and deodorants. In our today's session we are going to discuss face creams, suntan lotion and shaving cream. We have planned our today's session like this, that we will start with the introduction to creams. Then we will discuss cold creams and vanishing cream, their function and ingredients. We will take up the suntan lotions. Then we will take up an important factor in these lotions, which is called SPF factor. And then we will talk about shaving cream and finally we will summarize our today's work. Creams hold an important position in the field of cosmetics. They are basically emulsions of water in oil or oil in water. Means mostly creams are, whether they are used for medical purpose or cosmetic purpose, they are basically emulsions. After the First World War, the number of cosmetic companies increased. New ingredients and formulations gave them opportunities to promote skin products with a wider range of abilities and functions. This led to the products developed as powder creams, tissue creams, foundation creams, hand creams, cleansing cream, youth cream and so forth, because these companies, they wanted to sell their product. So, the old names cold cream and vanishing cream, they became almost obsolete for this purpose. Now, since the companies are not using these names because they have to sell their products to the consumer, but as far as a scientist or a chemist is concerned, the creams are still can be divided into two types, cold and vanishing, and then certain ingredients are added to them to have some added properties. We will talk about the cold cream first. Cold cream derives its name because it leaves behind a cooling effect on skin. It is emulsion of water in oil type, means large quantity of oil and less quantity of water in it. The concept of cold cream is quite ancient. Credit for the invention is usually given to Galen, a 2nd century Greek physician who developed an emulsion of beeswax, oil, rose petals and water to apply in the skin. The cream was designed to moisturize and condition the face and to help remove the harsh makeup. Typically used to remove the makeup from the face and soften the skin, these are the two basic functions of cold cream. It can heavily moisturize the dry skin, can also be used as a balm for dry cracked lips. If the lipstick is not used, even the cold cream can be used to cover the lips. It can also be used as a shaving cream. What are the ingredients of cold cream? Let us understand. The main ingredient here is a white beeswax. White means the beeswax which is obtained, it is purified. Then mineral oils, water, borax, perfume. These are the basic ingredients in a cold cream. Olive oil or almond oil, which were used as ingredient earlier, are not used now because they get rancid quickly. So, instead of this almond oil or other natural oils, the mineral oil is used these days. Now, these ingredients which are added to cold cream, what are their functions individually? Beeswax acts as a base for the cream. Borax is used for the formation of soap. Now, why the soap is required? Actually, soap is required for the purpose of emulsification. And how this soap is formed, I will discuss in the next slide. Then mineral oil is used as emollient. When borax is dissolved in water, it produces boric acid and sodium hydroxide. And then it is added to beeswax. The beeswax contains an acid which is called cerotic acid. Now, this sodium hydroxide which is formed by the dissolution of borax in water, it reacts with this cerotic acid, forming the sodium salt of it, sodium cerotate. And this acid is about 13% in the beeswax. So this forms now an anionic emulsifier, while the boric acid buffers the system. The emulsifier created by the chemical reaction makes the emulsion of oil and water in the cold cream more stable. Means, I will repeat, what happens when borax is dissolved in water, it forms sodium hydroxide and boric acid. Sodium hydroxide reacts with the cerotic acid present in the beeswax and forms a sodium salt of that long chain fatty acid that acts like soap and helps in the emulsification of the oil present in it. And the boric acid which is being formed, that acts as a buffer. Now, this is a common formulation of a cold cream, about 22% beeswax, white mineral about 50%, then distilled water is 26%, 0.8% borax, and then perfume is added to it. Manufacture of cold cream. Now, this manufacturing for cold cream also requires a technique. First, the oily components are heated to about 70 to 80 degrees Celsius. Oily component means the mineral oil or the beeswax, and in some other cases any other oil if it is added. In a separate vessel, borax is dissolved in water at about 70 degrees Celsius. Then the melted oily component is added to the borax solution rapidly with constant stirring, and then this mixture is cooled to about 40 degree, and then fragrance is added. Fragrance is not added before, because at high temperature the perfume will be evaporated. And finally, it is packed into the tubes, bottles or whatsoever container are being used. Next, we take up vanishing cream. Vanishing cream gets the name from the fact that it leaves no trace when rubbed into the skin. That is, it almost vanishes. It is an emulsion of oil in water type, means less amount of oil and more amount of water in it. Vanishing creams are more easily washed off and maintained in comparison to cold creams, as it is harder to wash off the oil phase of cold creams. The first commercial vanishing cream was named as Hazeline Snow, and it was introduced in 1892, but a large scale production of vanishing creams began in 1904. And as I mentioned before, earlier the creams were named as vanishing cream and cold cream. Vanishing cream was generally used in summer, and it was also named as summer cream, whereas the cold cream was used in the winter, and it was also called as winter cream. Vanishing creams, which can also be called as stearate creams, were known for their smooth, dry feel on the skin and their pearly sheen. Vanishing creams had the advantage of being non-greasy, which made them suitable for the women with oily skin. These are generally used during the day, and they are also advertised as a day cream. These are also referred to as a finishing creams. Means, to vanishing cream, different names were given even the early years also. Colored vanishing creams in white, flesh, Rochelle and natural shades are also used as makeup foundation creams. Then uses of vanishing creams: used as adhesive for makeup powders, reduces loss of moisture from dry skin, smoothens the skin and keeps it soft, prevents skin from roughness and cracking. The common ingredients of vanishing cream are stearic acid, an alkali like QOH or triethanolamine, a polyol like glycerin. Polyol means that type of compound which has more than one hydroxyl group in it. Glycerin, you know, contains three hydroxyl groups. Then water is the major content in these vanishing creams, and then some perfume is also added. The functions of different ingredients which are present in vanishing cream can be explained like this: that alkali reacts with some of the stearic acid to form a soap, which then acts as emulsifier. As in cold cream, we found that the sodium hydroxide obtained from boric acid formed the soap on reaction with the cerotic acid obtained from beeswax. Here we are directly adding stearic acid, and the alkali that we add is either potassium hydroxide or triethanolamine. Then the polyol or glycerin acts as a humectant. It prevents the loss of moisture and also prevents the cream from drying and cracking during storage. Sodium stearate crystals gives pearly shine. Now, the sodium stearate is formed by the reaction of this sodium hydroxide and stearic acid, or it may be, if it is potassium hydroxide used, it will be potassium stearate, and if it is a triethanolamine used, then it is a triethanolamine with the stearic acid. The common formulation of vanishing cream can be explained like this, that stearic acid is roughly 22.5%, triethanolamine 1.5%, potassium hydroxide 1%, glycerin 6%, and remaining 69% is about water, and then some perfume and color may be added to it. Then the term pearly sheen, which discussed, actually is formed in the vanishing creams itself, and it fascinated cosmetic chemists of the time. As the sheen was associated with quality, chemists were keen to reproduce the effect. Actually, it was just that cream with a more sheen looks good. It was eventually discovered that the pearliness was due to the formation of platelet like sodium cerate crystals in the mixture, or potassium salt obviously. These reflected and refracted light to produce the sheen. These crystals are like this, very small crystals, maybe fine needles or small platelets which are there, and they reflect the light and causes the sheen in the vanishing cream. Then next we move on to suntan lotion. Now this term suntan, sunscreen and sunblock, these are commonly used. Suntan is a very misnomer. Actually what happens, I discussed when we discussed about the anatomy of skin, that melanin is present in the skin. When light falls over it, to prevent the flow of light into the skin, there is a natural process, these melanin molecules start moving towards the surface, that is towards the epidermis, and tanning of the skin occurs. So if there is any chemical which fastens this process of the movement of melanin towards the skin, that should be called as sun tan, because that is producing a tan like that sun produces. But what we are using these days in these creams, we are using certain substances which prevent or block the UV rays which falls on the skin, so that the harm created by UV light to the skin can be prevented. So we are not using any suntan, we are using actually a material that can be caused as sunscreen, or it may also be called as sunblock. But a perfect sunblock can be clothing that is entirely opaque to the ultraviolet light. So a perfect sunblock is also not there. So the currently the only term allowed by the FDA and states and even in our country is sunscreen. But I am using here the suntan lotion because this term is mentioned as such in the syllabus. But the term used should be sunscreen for this purpose. Sunscreen is a cream, lotion, spray, gel or other topical product that absorbs or reflects some of the sun's ultraviolet radiation and thus helps protect against sunburn. Now, in order to understand this, let us see the electromagnetic spectrum, the rays which comes from the sun. These are the infrared region, this is the 400 to 800 is the visible region. The UV region is here, 400 nanometer to this site, up to about 100 nanometer, and then this UV rays are further divided into different portion. A region from 320 to 400 nanometer, this is called UVA rays. Then from 280 nanometer to 320 nanometer, it is called UVB rays, and the rays from 280 nanometer to about 100 nanometer, they are absorbed by the ozone layer and they do not come on the earth. So from the sun, the UV radiation that we are getting, they are of two types here, UVA and UVB. That is the radiation from 280 to 320 UVB and then 320 to 400 nanometer UVA rays. We have to protect our skin from the radiation in this range. So we must apply certain substances on the skin which absorb the radiations of this wavelength. Then UV penetration into the skin is like this, that UVB rays cross over the epidermis, whereas UVA rays even cross over the dermis region, and harm produced by the UVA rays is even more. But if some screen is there like here, then these UVA or UVB rays can be reflected, means they cannot enter the skin. So we will call it as a material sunscreen, and sunscreen may be such that it may also even absorb and let not these rays pass into the skin. So, there can be two mechanisms, and on the basis of these two mechanisms, sunscreen materials can also be classified into two groups. The basic ingredients of a sunscreen can be inactive ingredients of the vanishing cream or cold cream, and then active ingredients which act like a sunscreen. They may be organic chemical compounds that absorb UV light, or they may be some other metal salts which reflect the UV light and does not allow it to pass into the skin. The organic materials which are generally used for this purpose are amino benzoic acid derivatives, benzophenones, some cinnamates and salicylates. Actually, these are the compounds which have such functional groups where their electrons get excited by the absorption of these UV rays. So, UV rays are used up here and then they cannot enter the skin. Inorganic particulate materials, which are generally metal salts, they reflect and scatter the UV light, and materials generally used are titanium dioxide, zinc oxide, or a combination of both. One way of dividing them is by what wavelength they block. There may be a broad spectrum sunscreens, they block ultraviolet radiations of UVA and UVB both, or it may be a UVA blocking sunscreen, UVB blocking sunscreen, but generally this type of classification is not used for selling these sunscreen items in the cosmetics. Then other type, as I discussed before, that they can be classified on the basis of which type of absorber they have. If they are using a chemical UV absorber, then they will absorb the UV light, but it will be for a amount of certain time. Such creams cannot work for a longer time. They also need time to bond with the skin, so do not work right away. So, they must be applied to the skin at least 15 to 20 minutes before a person is going to sunlight, and they are harder to rub off because they are mixed up with some oily substances. Then the second type, which have physical reflector, which we discussed, containing zinc oxide or titanium oxide, etcetera. Then these tiny metal salt particles, they work like a foil and they reflect UV away from the skin. They do not need time to bond with the skin. They can be just applied and they are available for their function right away, and they can be easier to rub off or can be easily washed out. Then along with this sunscreen, whenever you find any sample in the market, it is sold with certain number, which is called SPF, like SPF 10, SPF 15, SPF 50 and so on. What is this SPF? SPF is called sun protection factor, and it is a measure of how well a sunscreen will protect skin from UVB rays, particularly the kind of radiations that causes sunburn, damages skin and can contribute to skin cancer. For example, SPF 15. It means that 1/50th of the burning radiation will reach the skin. Assuming sunscreen is applied evenly at a thick dosage of 2 milligram per centimeter square, means 1 centimeter square portion of the skin, if it carries at least 2 milligram of this cream with the SPF 15, then 1/15th of the radiation will enter. Suppose it is SPF 20, then 1/20th portion will enter. It means higher the SPF factor, better is that particular cream. But it is not always necessary to use, because if a person is going for shorter period, then even a cream with the lower SPF number can be used, because they can be calculated that for how much time a cream will be affected like this. If the skin of a person would normally burn after 10 minutes in the sun, applying an SPF 15 sunscreen would allow him to stay in the sun without burning for approximately 115 minutes, because the skin gets burned in 10 minutes when the full radiations are falling. Now, we are using an SPF cream with 15 factor, means 1/15th of the light is passing through it, 1/15th of the rays are passing into the skin, and this multiplied by 10 means for 150 minutes. So, this is a rough estimate that depends on the skin type, intensity of the sunlight and amount of the sunscreen used. Because if a person is not using the sunscreen to the this strength of 2 milligram per centimeter square, then even this blocking will be for lesser time. Then next we take up another type of cream called shaving cream. Shaving cream is also sold in the form of shaving soap or shaving foam. It is a cream applied to the face to facilitate shaving. It can also be used on other parts of the body wherever the shaving is required. Shaving is the removal of hair by using a razor or any other kind of bladed implement to cut it down to the level of skin. Now, what are the basic requirements? First thing, since blades are made up of metal, they are sharp. When they will touch the skin and it will be pressed over the skin, then the cells in the skin can also be damaged. So, we need a cream that produces a slipperiness so that damage to the skin is less. For that, these shaving creams are being used. As I use the term shaving foam is not different from the shaving cream. Only thing is that it is present in the cans and along with some propellant. Whereas shaving cream may be there in the tube and then it is applied with the help of a brush. And shaving soap is the further dried and it can be wetted and then again applied with a brush on the skin. Uses of shaving cream: it lubricates the cutting process, swells the keratin. You know, hair are made up of keratin and this keratin is basically protein. If it absorbs little water, it will swell up and it will soften. So, cream helps in doing this process. It softens the hair and the cutting becomes easier, and it provides a residual film to the soothe the skin. Then the common ingredients of shaving cream. Shaving creams commonly consist of emulsion of oil in water. Oil in water means like cold cream. You remember while discussing the cold cream, I said that cold creams can be used as shaving cream just by mixing a small amount of soap into it. Then the second component here is soap or surfactant, and third component is basically water. So, these are the basic ingredients of shaving cream. Formula can be shown like this, that it contains stearic acid, triethanolamine, lanolin and glycerin. These are four the ingredients of basically of any cold cream. So, a soap is found by reaction between triethanolamine and stearic acid. Lanolin is there as a emollient, glycerin as a humectant, and then polyoxyethylene sorbitan monostearate is again a sort of soap or surfactant present, and then water mainly, perfume is added, and we have the formulation of a shaving cream. So, let us summarize now what we have discussed today. We started our discussion about the creams, and then we discussed that what are cold creams, their function and ingredients, and then we discussed about vanishing cream, their function and ingredients. But I said that these days creams are not sold under the names of cold cream and vanishing cream, rather companies are selling them under different names. Because every company sells with the same name, the sale is less, and that is the aspect there. But a little modification have also been done by the companies. Suppose an oily ingredient is increased in the cold cream and it is made slightly thin, then we call it as a body lotion. If certain ingredient is added that helps in the reducing the wrinkles, then we call it as an anti-wrinkle cream. And anti-wrinkle cream can be cold cream as well as in the vanishing cream. Then the same cream is sold by some other companies as the age-defying cream. Then there are certain cracks in the foot. Then cracks can be removed by using a cold cream. So, that company is selling cold cream in a different form as a foot cream, similarly as a lip balm, and many other names are given to these companies, but basic products are the same. Then we discussed about the suntan lotions. As I said, the name is not used these days, it is not permitted. The permitted name is sunscreen. Sunscreens are again sold as creams, lotion, and basic aim is to prevent the entrance of UV radiations that fall on our skin into the body. And every sunscreen has got a particular number called the SPF factor. SPF factor determines that for how long a particular cream will be more effective for preventing the UV radiations. Then we discussed about the shaving cream. Now, in our next session, we will talk about artificial flavors and essential oils and how these are used for making perfumes.